All right, so up to this point, we have created a data model to be able to handle user CRUD operations, right? We created a schema that defined what a user is, right? That has a username, password, first name, last name, date of birth. All sorts of things would go here, right? Contact information, address would go all in this schema. And we created a model that encapsulate all the CRUD operations for that data type, right? Being able to create them, read them in several ways, either by user ID or by credentials. You can add several other finder methods. These are referred to as finder methods, right? Find by all sorts of criteria, either by user ID or by credential, or by username, by whatever criteria you care to implement. We did updates and remove user, but in our application, this is we're building an application that allows for users to create content, right? And the content includes being able to create websites, websites having pages, pages having widgets, right? So let's work on being able to have users create websites, right? And create that relationship, okay? In a relational data model, there are a couple of ways to do that. Typically, two main ways. Either to create a relationship between parent and children, right? The user being the parent of the websites, right? There's a relationship there. There's one user related to many websites, right? We usually call that a one-to-many relationship. And there's two fundamental ways of doing that in relational data models, right? You would have the children keep track of who their parent is, right? So all the websites, for instance, would have some reference. We would use the ID of the parent to know that, hey, we all belong to that parent, right? And then we can do a query, join the two, right? You know, giving a user, we can find all the websites for that particular user. Another way is to have a mapping where you have, you know, an additional table that has references to both. Has a reference to the parent and has references to the children, saying, hey, this parent is the owner of all these children, right? Usually we refer to it as like a mapping table, right? A table that maps parents and children. It's the most generic way of implementing relationships between two types of entity. But that's it. That's really it. There's no other alternative. Those are the two main alternatives to create relationships between records, pieces of data. Mongo goes a little further. It allows you to do that, right? Be able to have references between the two. But you have many other options, right? Another option that you have is that it becomes obvious when you think about this in an object-oriented world, right? In an object-oriented world, the way the parent has a relationship with the children is that you can have a collection or an array or some list at the parent level that can contain actual instances of the children, right? So that the instances could be navigated following the pointers, right, in the collection, you can then get a hold of the child. Yes? So in that sense, you have yet another way of representing this, right, in an object-oriented world, right? You can have parents having collections of pointers to the children, and Mongo goes a little bit further, right? Instead of having actual pointers to the children, you can have the actual instance living in the collection, right, of the parent, right? In the array, the whole instance of the child could be, you know, embedded inside of the array, right? As opposed to, you know, a reference that allows you to go fetch the child, right? So, yes, you would run into duplications, yes, or risks of duplication. But from a point of view of object oriented, right? You deal with these things, right? It's a very common thing that you deal with object oriented programming, right? Obviously, in a relational database, you would you would avoid these kinds of duplications because you run the risk of inconsistency, right? That what if you copy this over and over several places and you want to change one, but the other ones don't change, right? So you depending on who you're asking, you might have two different results. And yes, we have to deal with those issues as well, right? But whenever possible, when the data is going to be consumed by a front end, right, it's better to store it in the way that it's going to be consumed, right? To increase the speed in which you retrieve these things. Okay, so I like to talk about how to implement these things. All right, implement these relationships in MongoDB. Okay. All right. So here's the user schema, and what we want to be able to do here is create a relationship between a user and its children websites, right? One way to do that, right, is to have declare here websites, right, as an additional attribute of the user schema, and declare this as an array. Okay, there's an array that's gonna, this is gonna be a collection of things, right? Collection of objects, and there's two options that you have here, right? This could be an array of references to instances of websites, right? Or this could be instances, the actual instance of the website living in here, okay? If the website is not going to be shared by anyone else, right? I am the only user, I'm the only creator of this website. Preferably, I would like the entire instance living in here, okay? Because when I query, right, I could have the entire data copied over to the front end, right? There's no need for me to go back to the server. If this website instead is being shared among several users, right, there's several developers perhaps, right, working on the same website, then preferably this would be an instance, it would be a reference to an instance, right, that is accessible from many different points of view, right? So it depends what the use cases are, right? And whatever those use cases are, forces you to one implementation or another, right? Over here, we're going to use. I would prefer to use references myself. One of the things is that if you have the website living, the instance of the website in here, right, in the user instance, that precludes you from treating the websites, right, as a whole collection unto itself. Right, you know, if I want to be able to, you know, make a system-wide update on all websites, that would preclude me from doing this easily because I would have to first iterate over all the users, and then all the websites inside of the arrays of each one of the users. It's much more cumbersome. Instead, if this is a reference, a website would live on its own collection. Right, I would have all the instances of the websites out there. I still have references from here from the user, but I would be able to treat the websites as an entire collection, regardless of who the user is, right? So again, it depends on the use cases, right? If you're never going to run into the case where you need to treat websites outside of the context of a user, right? If there's no such use case, then by all means, you should have the instance of the website live inside of the array in here. Okay, but if you have a use case where you have a system admin that, you know, regardless of who the user is, I would like to be able to remove this website, regardless of who the user is, I'd like to have a listing of all the websites, right? Then, you know, if that use case is important to you, then it's preferably to have it as its own collection. It depends, right? But my point is that MongoDB gives you the options, right? Which option do you want to go, right? Whereas in a relational database, you don't have that option. Right. It has to be either a mapping table, right, or the children having a foreign key up to the parent. Those are the only choices, right? Over here, you can have, there's many more options available to you. Okay, all right. So what we're gonna do here is we're gonna add a reference to the website. We haven't created the website. Let's create the websites first, right, so that we can reference them from here. Okay. All right. So let's create the websites. In the user model, notice that we have refer to the user model with this name, user model, right? That's important because those names that we give them, right, those names are is how schemas are going to refer to children or parents, right, if they're referring to one another. Okay, so let's create the website. Let's create a schema for the website. So this would be a website schema.server.js. And in here, we're going to have a module exports function. And in here, we're going to create, we're going to use Mongoose to create an instance of the schema. So here would be, we have a website schema. It would be mongoose.schema. And to keep it simple, we'll just say that it has a name and a string. It's a string. Okay? Just to keep it simple. All right, so here we have the website schema. And we're going to return it. Okay. There we go. Let's keep it simple right now. Let's create a model that that allows us to create the CRUD for this website schema. So we would have a model here. So this would be website model server JS. And again, we would create a module for this. And this would be var, let's use Mongoose again. To create our model, let's load the schema from the local file that we have locally. So it's a website schema. Now that we have the schema, we can then create the model, right? The Mongoose model for being able to manipulate this. So we'll create a website model. This will be a Mongoose model. And the name that we're going to give it is website model. And it's going to be validating the website schema. Okay, so that's the model. Very good. Let's see. And this is going to return the website model. Okay. Actually, no. We're going to have an API in here, right? We're going to have an API that declares on how to be able to create these websites. So I have an API. Let's start off with just creating a website. So we might have something here like create website. Implement it by function of the same name that takes as argument a website. All right? And presumably, we would use something like website model dot create website. Yes? All right. All right, so what else we have here? So, all right, so what we want to be able to do is create the relationship between the two, right? Users and websites. And again, we have several options. Okay, one of the options is to, in the user schema, right, say that these are going to be, let's see if I can load the other schema, the website schema. That's one of my options. Website schema, let me load that. Require. Let's see, we can go up one. Where am I? So dot dot, go up one, website, and then go down to website schema. Now that I have the schema, I can say that these websites are instances of website schema. Okay? This is referred to as an embedded schema. Okay? An outer schema, the user schema, contains instances. Okay, not references, instances of website schema objects, right? So for instance, you might have a valid instance might be something like var user, and you might have here something like username Alice, right? And then websites would be an array, right? Would be an array of object instances, right? Would be something like you know, the name of the website, right? Like Facebook.com. That would be a valid instance of a website, and then you would have here another one, Twitter. Right? Both of them would have unique identifiers. ID, you know, something like 234, this would have its own ID when they were created. Okay, it would look something like that. That's how it would be stored inside of Mongo. If I would ask, hey, the Alice user, can I see the object, Alice user? It would contain, right, an array of instances of these websites. Make sense? Nope, no collection of its own. Right? It would only exist inside of this array. Right? It would not have its own collection. Okay? That's an option. Right? I don't like this option. Well, it depends. Again, it depends on the use case. Right? You would go this way if, again, if you don't have a use case where you're manipulating websites on their own, irrespective of who the user is, then by all means you could do this, right? But that means that all the life cycle of these websites would only be dependent on the life cycle of the parent, right? Right. So if you remove the user instance, all the instances of the website are gone. Yes, right. Right. So if you remove the Alice instance, this object, all the website instances are gone. Right. I'm sorry. Well, it depends. I don't know. If again, it depends on the use cases. Right. If the use case is that you know, if Facebook, you say I want to leave Facebook, do you think Facebook actually removes me? Probably not. Right. Maybe it does like a soft delete, and keeps everything right in its database. Right. So do we really want to remove this? Probably not, right? So it depends, right? If I have a whole bunch of blog posts and I leave the blog, the community, do my posts go away with me? It depends, right? Maybe, right? If I leave Google Plus, all my postings and all my content, does that also leave? Probably not. Probably all that stays there, right? Because probably there's comments associated with that. Right, if I remove the user, I remove the blog post, I remove the comments, the replies, all that. Right, I don't know. I don't know that Google or any blog it would actually do that. Right, probably what they have is this is all implemented in separate collections. So we're not going to go this way. We're not going to go that way. But it certainly is an option. Okay, I'm going to just leave it commented, just as an option. I'm not going to remove it. I'm going to leave it there as an option. The other option, the one we are going to do, right, is the following. It's going to be an array, not of instances, right? It's going to be an array of references to instances that live elsewhere in a different collection. Okay, so that's what we're going to do. So what we're going to do here is we're going to say the type of this object instance, right, is going to be mongoose dot schema. Right, type. Okay, and then what is it? Object ID. Okay, this is the type. That's the type of the underscore ID. Remember the underscore ID, right? Those are the types of those objects, right? It's represented as a string, right? But it is abstracted. In the framework is referred to as an object ID. Okay. So that's the type, and the reference. Okay. This reference, you tell it. Okay. Well, you told me that I'm going to store an underscore ID, right? The somebody's primary key, of what object? What am I referring to? You know, so what we're going to say here is that these are websites. Website model, right? This is the name that we are giving here when we declare the model for that schema, right? So these two match. This website model matches this website model, right? That's how it knows that when you create instances of a website and it creates those underscore IDs, it knows that those IDs are also being referred to by some other parent collection. Yes? Everybody okay? All right. Okay. So let's play around with that. Let's play around with that. I want to be able to create a website, right? And I want to be able to insert it inside of this array, right? So let's do that. Let's do that. Right, so where are we in the assignment? Let's see that we were implementing. We were right here, right? Being able to log in. We can log in. We should be able to go into websites, right? And presumably, I should be able to see the array of websites right here, right? We don't have that, right? That's implemented at this route. Let's see what we have so far implemented for that. I'm guessing that is somewhere under public assignment views website. Excuse me. Website list. And this is the controller that should go fetch all those websites. And right now, excuse me, it's implemented as follows. Website, find websites for user, and we provide the user ID, right? That's what we have so far, okay? Let's see if we can step through that. In the source views website, we have website list controller, and presumably here's where that is occurring. Oops. So if I refresh, I should be stepping into that code. What happened? Website. What's going on? Hello? Uh-oh. Do I have a breakpoint somewhere? Let me restart this. Oh! I have an error here. It's not an object ID. Oh, is it types? Oh, thank you. User schema is types. All right, thank you. Try to do that again. Okay, so restart it. So if I refresh this. Uh-oh, what's going on? What is going on? Do I have a breakpoint somewhere? This was working 2 seconds ago. Debugging, listening. Inspect. Do I have an error somewhere? I don't. Network, console. Ajax, Angular, it's going out to Google API and my network must be down somehow, right? Yeah, I've been having all these network issues today. I'm gonna just use a local version of AngularJS so I don't run into this problem. Let me go back to my index page and make that change. I believe I have a copy locally in JS. Yes, I do. So let me change my index page. Instead of going out to fetching Angular out there, I'm going to go dot dot, again, JS and AngularJS. And do the same thing for my Angular route. Okay? All right, let me do that. Let's see. Did I go too far? Oh no. Yeah, I went one too far. the server running. JS. Oh, I don't have the min version of these. I have the exploded version. Okay, let's see. All right, let's try this again. So Alice, login, inspect, and I believe I had a breakpoint somewhere in here. In the source, let me put it down below. And when I go to websites, it comes here, and I have the user ID, 5829. I believe I'm parsing the integer, which I shouldn't, right? So let me fix that. In the controller, there it is. This is where I'm parsing the int, but it's not an integer. So let me reload that. And now do I have the ID? I do have the ID. Very good. And I'm going to fetch the websites. Presumably, that's going to make a request to the server. Let's see. Did we implement that? It's a promise, so it sounds like we did. Let's go in there. Looks like we are using a server. The server should be going here somewhere. Let's see. Assignment. A services website service probably is going through here, no? Okay, this is a get find for user. So it must be coming in here. Let's put a breakpoint right there. And let's say continue. It didn't go in there. Website service. Let's see, let's try it again. Refresh. Go. Oh, it doesn't seem to come in here. Assignment service. Did I ever load this? I did, didn't I? There it is. Website service server. It's this one. Is it being loaded? Let me see. Let me put a breakpoint right there. Yeah, I haven't done that yet. Okay, let me continue. All right, let me refresh. Continue. Oh, I know. I the server wasn't started on debug mode. Right, that's why it wasn't stopping there. All right, so it's coming here. All right, so this is using the old, right? This is using the old style of retrieving data. It's not even using a model, right? So let's fix that. It's using the old array, your static array. So let's fix that. So I'm going to continue. It's going to come back with empty. So let's fix that. We'll say we'll need a model here, right? We're going to have to pass it a model here. And in the model, presumably what we're going to do is we're going to say something like model dot, you know, website model, right? Something like find websites for user, something like that, right? And we pass the argument request dot params dot, what do we call it? User ID, right? And we pass user ID to some model, which we don't have yet, right? We don't have that model. And this presumably is going to come back with a promise, and hopefully we'll get the list of websites right here, right? Websites. And we can then send back in the as a response the list of websites. Right, but this doesn't exist yet, right? This doesn't exist yet, right? So the implementation would be in the model. The model is being passed to us from app.js, right? Right, there it is, model, right? And this model server, it's only loading the user model, right? It never loaded the website model, right? We never loaded it. So let's create that as well. We'll say that this is the website model. Implement it in website, right? We just implemented 2 seconds ago. And there's the API, right? So website model will be in there. And right now, the only thing that we have in there is creating a website. We don't even have find user, you know, find websites by anything. We don't have that just yet. And the API, I believe, was something like find, what is it that we called it? find all websites for user. I don't like that name. So find websites for user, something like that. So let's add that to the API and implement it in a function of the same name. And presumably we're passing a user ID as an argument. So here we would do what? Something like return website model dot find, right? Find those websites that belong to a user, right? So let's implement this first, right? See, I think this is easier. How would we filter? How would we filter? Presumably there's lots of websites, right? So there's an array of websites. One thing that we could do is what? We could say, hey user, I know you have an array of websites. You know, give me that. We could go that way, right? Hey user model, I know you have an array. I'll return that. Or we could ask the website models and say, hey, do any of you know who you belong to? Right? Do you have a reference to your parent? Right? So return those websites whose parent is, and I pass the user ID. So there's two ways, right? Let's see, which way do we want to go? Well, we already went the way of creating the websites inside of the array of users. So let's go that way. All right, let's go that way. For that, we're gonna need the user model, right? Because the user model has access to the array of websites, right? I don't have it here, so we would need the access to the user model right here, right? We don't have it. So we would need like the entire model over here. So let's pass the model object here, right? So that we can have access to all the models, right? Including the user model, right? So let's pass it in a function maybe called setModel, right? So that in that function, we could say, I can pass the model and copy it in a local variable. And say model equal model, right? So we'll declare it maybe over here, var model. It's empty right now. I don't have a model, okay? And I can then use in the model, there will be the website model, there will be the user model, the pages model, all the models will be there. Okay, all the models will be there. So to do that, let's go back to the model where we created it. Right, here's the user model, right? We are being added to this map. And way, way up here, right, is where we are loading these model in the user service, right, in the website service. Here's the model, maybe we do have it already. Model, website, model, wait a minute, where am I? This is the website service, no, not Siri. Let's see what we have here. We have the service. Let me see how we're architecting this. Sorry. Here's the app.js, right? Here's the app.js. And here are the models. Oh, okay. So I guess we could do it here, right? We can say website model dot set model, and we can pass the model. Right, and same thing for the user model. We can say set model, and we can pass the model. Right? Do we implement for the user model? Probably not. We did implement it for the website model, right? Set model. There it is. We wanted something similar, but for the user. Right. So let's go to the user model. User model. Right. We're gonna implement right here. Set model. So we can pass the model to everybody. So everybody has access to the model. All right. All right. Okay, so now we have that, right? Now we can go back to the website model, and if somebody asks for all the websites for a user, and we have the user ID, we can first find, we can use model dot find the user model. And we can say find websites for user. Right, and can pass it the user ID. right? We can find the websites for that user. Okay? Which we need to implement, right? So in the user model, we can implement find. We can implement find websites for user, which the implementation would be something like a function, find websites for user. We pass the user ID. We first need to find the user. Once we find the user, we can then return the array of websites. We can say return user model dot find by ID, the user ID. So we have that user find user by ID, and then once we have that user, we could do the then right here, and right here we have the user object. Once we have the user object, where are the websites? The websites are right here. We can say return user.websites. Right? Those are the actual websites, right? If we put a breakpoint here and we restart the server, right? If we do a refresh, do we break something? The query, okay, so it's here, right? I'm going to continue. Find, it's over here, right? Find, is this where it comes from? Yeah, it is, right? So let's continue. Okay, there it is. So it comes in here. The request params user ID is that ID. Let's step in through there. Let's go in there. So it would use, there is find, we're passing the ID, right? There is find websites for user. We can step in through there. So we're here, we're going to find, ooh, that's a misspelling, right? Sorry, it's find by. No, it's find by ID, right? So find by ID. Let me restart the server again. Is it find by ID? It is find by ID, right? It was right. It was just in the quiz. No, yeah. let me put a breakpoint right here. Let me restart. Let me continue. Take out the breakpoint there. Continue. Okay, so find by ID. There it is. Let's see if it finds it. Did it find a user object? Yes. And notice that the array is empty, right? The array is zero because there are no websites, right? There are no websites. So this is going to go back where? It's going to go back. It's going to go back right here. So there should be a breakpoint right there. So continue. And there's the array, right? The array of websites is empty because right now there's nothing in it, right? There's nothing in it, right? So when we continue, the breakpoint should continue right here on the browser, and the browser comes back with an empty array. You see that? It's an empty array. There's nothing in it. So let's create a website. Let's create a website in here. Let's continue. So when I click on plus, it should navigate to website new. And website new, oops, did I get a console? Fail to load website new. Why? Website new. Is there no website new? Can you see that? Is it better with a white background? Let's see, wait a minute. I changed the background yesterday. Maybe white background might be better. Is that better? I think that looks better. No, for recording. I think it records better like that. There's much more contrast. All right, so we're definitely sending back something. So we want to create a website, yes? Okay, so let's create a website. So let's see, for the view, for website, I do have website new. Why is it telling me that I don't have it? Why does it say I don't have it? It says cannot load views website-new.html. Website-new.html. Website. Where's website? User website. There it is, right? User ID, website new. Views, website, website new HTML. Website new HTML. Why don't you see it? It says, fail to load, yada, 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 yada. Assignment, views, website, website new. Assignment, views, website. Did I misspell this anywhere? Website-new. Website-new. Really? Website-new. Let's see what the... the internet is down. Close that. All right, let me see if I can figure this out. Angular, yada, 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 views, website, website new, P1, P2, minus one, fail to load. Connection refused. Is my server down? Did my server crash? Oh, it did. Okay. All right, my server crashed. That's why. Not sure why. Let me see. Continue. All right, it navigates there. It did navigate. Okay. So my server had crashed. That's why it couldn't load it. All right. So I'm going to create this new website. And there's a control for that, right? So we have new here. That's the template for creating the new website. And it's going to go into my controller here. And create website is going to send it to the service. It's going to pass the user ID and the website, right? Notice that it's parsing the user ID. So I'm going to remove that as an integer, right? So it doesn't parse it as an integer. And it's going to pass it. It's going to pass the user ID, website is going to post, right? It's going to post that and then navigate to the list of websites, right? So I'm guessing create website is going to navigate to website service server. I'm guessing it's going to come right here in this create website right there, okay? I'm guessing that's where it's going to go. So I'm going to put here, I'm going to create Facebook. I'm going to say okay. Right, it's going to navigate here. Here's my website object. I created a bogus underscore ID. I don't really need that. I don't really need the user ID. And it's going to go into this create website, which is going to come here, I'm guessing. So if I say OK, there it is. So I'm in the server waiting to add this to the website, right? But notice that what's it going to do? It's going to want to create it and put it in the array of websites. That's the old way that we're doing it, right? Instead, what do we want to do? We want to push it into the array of websites of the user, right? Right, so we don't want this anymore. So let's remove this. We don't care about this anymore. What we want to do is use the model. We want to say model.websiteModel.createWebsite. Right, create website. We're gonna pass the user ID. The user ID is where it's user ID in the parameters. We can say request.params.userid, and then the actual website is in the body. It's right here. Right, so let me pass that as an argument, and presumably it's gonna come back saying, yeah, here's your new website. Right, there it is. It's going to come then, function, here's my brand new website having been created into the database, right? And I'm going to console log website. Right, the new website, and I'm going to respond sent back. It's JSON, this brand new website that I've just created. Okay, all right. So let's step through this. I believe website model did create. We do have create website, don't we? In the website model. Let's see, website model. Where are you? We do have create website, don't we? Yes, we do. So let's put a breakpoint right there. And so let's try this again. Did I restart the server? Let me restart. Let me refresh. I don't care about this anymore. Oops. Restart. Okay, refresh. Website. I want to create a brand new website. And it's Facebook. I say OK. I'm going to say OK. OK, so we're here. We have the website from the client. It's that object we created on the client, right? With oh, it's empty. Huh. Why is it empty? Why is it empty? Did we post? Did we post in the network? Let me see. There's our posts. Is this a post? HTTP URL request. It is a post. There it is. It's the ID, the model, the name. So the name is okay. The name is okay. Why is this not coming through in the body? Why is the body empty? Interesting. We are passing the data here. All right, so let me see what's going on here. Just a second. I'm gonna create website. I'm gonna just echo back. I'm gonna send back the actual object that I am posting, just to see what it's coming back. I'm gonna restart the server. So we're here, and we type something, and we say OK. Website. Do we mess it up in here, maybe? There's website. The data's there. The data is good. And we do the post. It's the correct URL. And when we come back, let's continue. Let's look at the network. Oh, it's still pending. Interesting. Why is it pending? Why is it still pending? What is this? What is this? Website, user, yada, yada, yada. Notice the ID is wrong, right? So somewhere, oh, look at that. What happened there? Somewhere we parsed it wrong, right? Let's fix that. That's in the website, probably website new, and the controller, website new controller, probably is parsing it somewhere. Where? Yeah, where? Where? You mean here from the console? Oh, here? Find everywhere where you have parsed. Okay, not in the modules. Public, JS, assignment, website. In the edit controller, let's remove all these parse ints, which are killing me. Okay, let me go back. Let me log in as Alice. Okay, and if I go to websites, there it is. I'm in the right place. Continue. And I have the websites right there. Okay, it's empty. Let's go. Keep going. All right, so if I say create new, okay, I have the correct user ID. Very good. And you have some bogus value here. I'm going to say okay. And Okay, I don't need to create the website ID because that's going to be created on the server side. So let me remove that. That's on the controller, website new controller. I don't need this anymore. All right, so let me refresh that. So if I on websites, I say new. Say okay. Wait, what? I still have the old code. Say okay. All right, there we go. Okay. Oh, it didn't break here. Why didn't it break here? Website. I didn't put a breakpoint here? I thought I had a breakpoint there. Oh, no, not there. In the model. Where's the model? In the website model. Where are you? Website model. There we go. We have create. Oh, it didn't go in here. Why didn't it go in here? Should have gone in here, right? What is it? Oh, I forgot to put the user ID as an argument. Okay. And the service, website server, service create, this should be breakpoint right there. Let me try it again. Let me refresh, add, new. All right, finally, we're here. Website. It's still empty. Interesting. So if I go keep going and I continue, what does my network say? So I sent the data. This is my post. No, here's my post. Where's my post? There it is. And I did send data. Name, the name was correct, but it came back empty. That's weird. All right, I'm not going to waste time debugging that. I'm going to just hard code this for now. So here's an object, and the name is Facebook. Okay? And so I'm going to pass it to the model. I'm going to go in the model with that website object, right? Which presumably I've parsed from the body. Okay? Let me restart that. And let me create a new website. I say okay. I take out that breakpoint and continue. So it comes in here. The new website object is there. I'm going to pass the user ID and the website. So if I go in there, I have user ID and website. Okay. Notice that this would create the website, right? But it would not add it to the user. The user would not know anything about this, but about this new website. We'll do that in a minute. So let's continue. Let's continue. And if you go to the database, let's see if that was added. Right. So show collections. And are we in the right place? Show DBs. And use the... I think it's this database. Show collections. I guess it's this one, right? So let's do that. Copy. db.websitemodels.find. Okay, we have that Facebook website that was created, but the Alice user, which I'm guessing it's this one, dbuser.find. Notice that the Alice doesn't know anything about websites, right? Notice that it doesn't have any not even an array, because when Alice was created, right, the website's property didn't even exist, okay? So here, when we create this website, we need to also add it as a reference to the array of references of websites to the user, okay? So let's do that. So when we create the website, we need to do a couple more things here, right? We can't just create and that's it. We need to continue doing a couple things. What do we do here? Well, we need to handle the coming back of the server. Once we have inserted the website and we're guaranteed that the website has been stored in the database, right? We're going to get back a callback and say, and say, oh, yep, here is your website object that I've just stored in the database, right? It's there. And what do we want to do here? We want to go add it to the user. So let's go fetch the user. We need to fetch the user. So the user is in model.userModel, right? Find the user by ID. I think we have. Don't we have that? Find user by ID. And we can pass this user ID right there. Okay? And that's going to come back with a user, right? So we can model. That's going to come back with a then, right, with the actual user object. Right, we have now the user object. Yes? Okay. Now that we have the user object, we can add the website we just fetched, that we just created 2 seconds ago, and add it to the array of Alice, right? So we can say user object that I just found you has a website's array, right? And we can push in here the website object we just fetched, okay? We can just push it in there. And then once it's pushed, this is in RAM, right? This is being done in RAM, right? In volatile memory. We have to save it back in the database, right? So we have to save it back, and we can say user object, right, save. Save is, hey, I've changed you here in volatile memory. I want you to persist this back in the database. Okay, I've changed in memory. I want you to persist it back in memory, right? And now we can say, okay, we're done. We've added the website, and we can return. We can return, right? To test this, I'm going to drop the Facebook. Since we don't have a since it's hard coded, if I run this again, it's going to insert Facebook again. I'm going to have two Facebook websites, of which one of them, the latest one, will be added, right? So I'm gonna empty my website model. I'm gonna say remove all websites, and so that if I look for websites, I don't have any websites. Everybody okay? All right. And I know my user doesn't have anything, right? Doesn't have any websites. Yes. So let's create this Facebook website. Let me restart. And in here, I'm going to continue. I'm going to do that again. I'm just going to say OK. There is my Facebook website. I'm going to continue. OK, so we're in here. I'm going to put a breakpoint right there. OK, it's going to insert the website, and then it's going to stop right here. It's going to continue. OK, there it is. So this is the website object that has just been inserted. Right, and to look at the data that came back from the database server, there it is, the name, the ID, right? And indeed, we can go here and ask for the website. There it is, Facebook has been added, right? So it's in the database. But Alice still doesn't know anything about it, right? Alice doesn't know anything yet. Okay? But it's Alice is about to know. We're going to fetch Alice by user ID. So we're going to say go. And it didn't work. is that the function? Is that the correct function? Maybe not, right? Let's see. User model, find user by ID. Yeah, find user by ID. Find user by ID. Huh. Did I misspell it? Find user model. Let me do that again. Let me restart. I'll step through this. Let me continue. Plus, go. Okay, continue. Continue. User model. Model, there it is. User model. There it is. Find user by ID. It's a function. Do we have a user ID? We do. Okay. Okay, let's step in there. There we go. Find user by ID. We have a user ID. User ID is good. User model. Okay, that looks right. Doesn't it look right? Continue. And it doesn't come back here. That's weird. Find user by ID. Find user by ID. Why are you not coming back? Find user by ID. Model.userModel. Find user by ID. User ID. Find by ID. I pass this ID. Find by ID. Is the ID wrong, maybe? Do we have Alice? Is that ID there? Yeah. Let me restart. For breakpoint right here. Plus. Add. Continue. We're here. User ID. What's the value? There it is. AA9, right? AA9 is... It's AA9. That's correct. And the database is AA9. Huh. Where? Find by ID. Find by ID. User model function model document field skip ID user ID and that's correct. Find by ID return. Interesting.
I'm sorry?
No, you don't have to. Why is it not? User model, find user by ID. User ID. Then, okay, I'm going to stop this. And if it's giving me an error, if there is an error, it would call right here, right? And this is the error. So let's do a console log error. Let's put a breakpoint right there. Let's see what it's complaining about. Let's do that again. Let's try that. Okay, we have that. Continue. Continue. And continue. Go. Oh, wait, what? Okay, it found the object now. I don't know why. Oh, it wasn't happy that I didn't give it an error. Is the user, is this the correct user? Let's see, is Alice in Wonderland and website is empty. Okay. All right, let's see. User object websites is an array, I don't know. And it's going to push this website object, and there's the object. And I'm going to run this. I'm going to continue. And let's see. Let's see what the database says. The database says user find dot pretty, and you'll notice that now Alice has this array over here. See that? It says website, right? It has IDs for that website, right? Back on the client over here in the network, you'll notice that my post where's my post? Here's my post, right? In my post, I didn't pass any data, right? Because we're hard coding it, right? We're hard coding that, right? So there's my post. I didn't send anything back, really, right? I didn't send anything back. But what about this user? I think do we retrieve this? Are we retrieving this? This is getting all the websites. You know, retrieving all the websites. So how could we retrieve all the websites, right? Well, we could retrieve the websites from the collection and say, hey, collection, give me all the websites. But the websites don't know who they belong to, right? They don't know who they belong to. So if I asked for all the websites, I would get everybody's websites, my websites, your websites, everybody's websites, right? Because there's no distinction. The only way to know which are the websites is, again, through go through the user model, right? Go through the user model and say, okay, find me all the websites for this particular user. Here's a user ID, and it returns that website. Now, this is returning. Look what it's returning. See that? Right now, we did do that, didn't we? Do that. We retrieved. Where is it? We did retrieve here in the websites for user. We did implement it, didn't we? Right here, right? Return model user model find websites for user, right? And we implemented it in the user model. There it is. Right, find websites for user. There it is. See that? User.websites, right? That's how it's retrieving. But what's coming back? What does the array have? It's just the IDs, right? It's not enough for the user interface to render them. Notice that it just has an IDs, right? It doesn't have the name of the website, right? It doesn't have any of the metadata, right? Because it's just an ID, and that's all it has. But there's some more magic that we can use, right? Before returning here, we could ask the database to, given these IDs, go on and populate it, right? Hydrate these objects, right? Go fetch all these instances, right? And populate that array as if these instances would have lived in that array all along, right? Go fetch all those instances, right? And rehydrate this array, okay? So to do that, we could do. Right here, when we find the user by ID, right in the model, right, we could say user, right, and we could say dot populate, right, and the particular field that we want to populate, right, we can say populate the websites, okay? Populate the websites, oops, right? And then execute that population, right? Okay? If we do that, and restart the server, if we refresh this, we can look at the query that goes out to the network. Oh, do we have a breakpoint somewhere? Let's see. Do we have a breakpoint? Website, header, all the websites. This should go where? Oh, wait a minute. Let me restart over here. The breakpoint. Let me refresh. Find websites for user. I think it's where? It's right here, no? Try that again. Okay, we're here. We get the user object. There it is. The documentation for populate is in the MongoJS. We can say MongoJS and look for populate. Oh, I don't have the internet. I think that's the correct syntax. But let me verify with my cheat sheet over here. Public website, user model, populate. Okay, so find. Yeah, it is. That's correct. Right. It's that's correct. So it's website. Populate. Find one, and then the user. Yeah, that's correct. Okay, so we can. Let me stop this for a second. Instead of the then, actually it's used as follows. It's find the user, and then we say dot populate the website, websites, okay? And then we execute. Oh, let's try that again. Okay. Notice what comes back now when I ask for this, right? When I come back, Notice that now I get the entire user object. Look at this. The website object, the child's website object, right, is now fully hydrated. See that? Right? Instead of just being an array of integers, right, and an array of IDs, right, it has the full-blown object, child object, repopulated in there, right? Fix the UI in the UI in the website. Where is it where do we render this? I think it's in the list, right? In the website list. In the website list. Let's see. Assignment views website list. It's actually what you get back is the entire user object. You could say user.websites. Okay, so if you re-render, there it is. There's Facebook, right? Facebook that comes back from the server. Does that make sense? Right? Now, typically, this object of the website might be a very heavy object, right? It might have tons of fields, right? A name, a description. Maybe a thumbnail, maybe has statistics. It might be a very large object. In our case, it's not, right? Our case is just a very simple, it's a very simple object, right? In the schema, if you look at the schema, the only thing that it has is just a name, right? There's not much there, okay? This could easily have, you know, dozens of fields, right? And so it'd be very expensive, right, to ask for the information and these are this array containing all these fields that I don't really need, right? I only need to populate this simple list. I just need the name. That's all I need, and the ID. That's it. Okay. So you can filter what is it that it gets hydrated, right? So that you can be very specific and says no. I don't need all those fields, right? I only need these particular fields, right? So you can be a little more specific. In the hydration, right, you can say comma the field that you want to hydrate, right? And you could this would be a comma separated list of fields, right? That all those fields that you list here will be instantiated, retrieved from the database, right? So if you restart and you come back, we have that name, right? We have name, right? Notice just plus we have the ID, right? Obviously, so we have the ID and the name. The ID, you always get the name, the ID, right? You can't say that you don't want the ID, right? Actually, I believe you can. You can subtract and say, I want all the fields, but I don't want these. So you can do it backwards. You can say, these are the fields that I want, or you could say, these are the fields that I don't want, right? So you can filter both ways, right? If you want most of the fields except a few that you don't want, you can subtract those. Right, so populate is very, very powerful. Okay. The other thing that we might want to do is in the schema. We could look at this in a completely different way, right? What we could do in the models is that instead of the user having an array of websites, right? The problem of doing it this way is that you always have to go through the user model to go get at the websites, right? Which we could be very cumbersome, okay? So the other way that you could do this is that from the website schema, instead say, right, that I want to keep track of the user, right? Instead of the parent knowing about the children, I could have the children know about the parent, right? This is more classical relational database. Now, this is how you would do it in a classical relational database implementation, right? It is the children who have foreign keys back to the parents, right? So in this case, you would have the same data type here. You would have the type mongoose.schema.types.objectid, right? And this would be referring to the user model, right? So that means that now, whenever you create a website, right, you would have to update first a user, so you can add it to the array of users of websites, right? And you have to update this this user and with the ID of the user that was created, or either or, right? You could choose. You could do both, or you could do one or the other. So there's three options, right? Add it to the array, add it to the so that the parent knows about the children, add it only to the children so that the child knows about the parent, or have both of them. Okay. In this case, the creation of the website, when we create the website, where is it? Create the website, that's models, website model. When you create the website right here, okay, what you do is that once you have the website object, right, you need to website object dot user underscore user, right? User. Notice what is the user? It's of type object ID. And that's exactly what we have here, right? Once we get the object of the user object, we can say website dot user is equal to the user object dot underscore ID. See that? Right? We can say the user and then we go back and save this. We save this. Save dot save. Because we just updated the website object, right? In RAM, we need to go back and persist it in the database, right? So be careful, right? Whenever you make a change in RAM in memory, right? Always make sure to go back and save it back into and persist it in the database. Make sense? All right, that's all the time we have for now. But what we saw today was the capability of being able to create relationships between parent and child objects, right? In three different ways, right? Either only parent, only child, or as a combination of both of them. All right, thank you.
What happens if we update the user? Do I have to, as in I update the user, do I have to...